Welcome to worship for this Sunday, the 21st of June, a midsummer service. The psalmist says, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations." We begin our worship with the hymn 124. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Let us pray. Creator God, before time began, you brooded over the waste of nothing. And in the risk of love, you spoke, and earth was born. And early in that first morning, in the dawning of creation itself, when the world was young, you made life, and watched it evolve in all its myriad forms. And through the violence of earthquake and eruption, the clashing of continents, our island home was forged. Out of the cold, sculpted by ice and fire, raging waters and winds, it emerged to flourish in all its majesty and life-sustaining loveliness. And so ye gave birth to all we know and hold dear, tainted only by the touch of human sin. And early in the morning, when the world least expected it, a newborn child crying in a manger bare announced in a faraway land that you had come among us, that you were one of us. Early in the morning, surrounded by respectable liars, religious bigots, anxious statesmen, very silent friends. You accepted the penalty for doing good, for being God. And in reconciling love for fallen humankind, you shouldered and suffered the cross. But early in the morning, a voice in a guarded graveyard and footsteps in the dew proved that you had risen in a love stronger than evil and death. Return to those and for those who had forgotten, denied and destroyed you, that you were alive forever. And through the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, in all your loving power with humankind until the very end of time. What had been first whispered behind locked doors now bursts forth in all its unstoppable truth. The ripples of that truth spreading far and wide, until early one morning it touched our island shores, announced in the grinding of a keel on a sandy beach and in the footfalls of a Celtic saint. And early this morning, in the company of the generations of the faithful who have gone before us, in the company of your church on earth and in heaven, we rise to the rising of this life itself and celebrate your creation, your life, your death and resurrection, your continuing love and concern for us. And so we gladly offer our worship and praise, and through our petitions we pray. Lord, bring new life where we have turned half-hearted from your ways. Grant forgiveness where we have hurt or where we have wounded others. And grant to each of us the joy and freedom of your life-giving Holy Spirit, where we are prisoners of ourselves and our own making. We ask it in the name and for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Saviour, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We now turn to the reading of God's word today from Isaiah chapter 43, verses 14 to 28. Listen and hear the word of God. This is what the Lord says, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. For your sake I will send to Babylon and bring down as fugitives all the Babylonians in the ships in which they took pride. I am the Lord, your Holy One, Israel's Creator, your King. This is what the Lord says, he who made a way through the sea, a path through the mighty waters, who drew out the chariots and horses, the army and reinforcements together, and they lay there, never to rise again, extinguished, snuffed out like a wick. Forget the former things, do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up, do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the desert and streams in the wasteland. The wild animals honour me, the jackals and the owls, because I provide water in the desert and streams in the wasteland to give drink to my people, my chosen. The people I form for myself that they may proclaim my praise. Yet you have not called upon me, O Jacob. You have not wearied yourself or me, O Israel. You have not brought me sheep for burnt offerings, nor honoured me with your sacrifices. I have not burdened you with grain offerings, nor wearied you with demands for incense. You have not bought any fragrant calamus for me, or lavished on me the fat of your sacrifices. But you have burdened me with your sins and wearied me with your offences. I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. Review the past for me. Let us argue the matter together. State the case for your innocence. Your first father sinned. Your spokesman rebelled against me. So I will disgrace the dignitaries of your temple, and I will consign Jacob to destruction and Israel to scorn. Amen. We are going to take a few moments to listen and reflect on a hymn by Keith and Kristen Getty. The hymn is Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory.
Of scripture you heard today was from the prophet Isaiah. When reading through this Isaiah chapter 43, what strikes me is how much that God truly works his purposes out in many ways. He works his purposes for the good and well-being of his people and for their sake. The God who loves us and who is faithful to us, the one who sent his Son to die for us, is ever at work to work his good purposes in us and for his church. God's purposes are revealed to us in the church in our time through the Spirit. In former days, his purposes were revealed to his people through the prophets. The prophets spoke the very words of God. They were God's messengers. The late Sir Winston Churchill was once asked to give the qualifications a person needed to succeed in politics, and he replied, "It is the ability to foretell what is going to happen tomorrow, next week, next month, and the next year, and to have the ability afterwards to explain why it didn't happen." Because God's prophets were correct all the time, they didn't have to explain away their mistakes. In Deuteronomy, we can read the words of Moses when he said, "If what a prophet proclaims in the name of the Lord does not take place or come true, that is a message the Lord has not spoken." And from Isaiah, we can read, "To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this his word, it is because there is no light in them." Isaiah himself was a man who had God's light in him, and he was not afraid to let it shine. He was God's messenger, his mouthpiece. God spoke his word to him, and then in turn Isaiah spoke to the people. In chapter 43, the people of Israel at that time were looking back at past times and ignoring the need for faith to move on. They were looking to God to redeem them like he did when he freed the Israelites from slavery in Egypt with the great Exodus. They would cry to God, and again he would hear and deliver them. A new Exodus would take place through a new desert. Isaiah says in verse 18, "Forget the former things. Do not dwell in the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it?" Was he saying you have to forget what happened in the past? It doesn't matter. Your history, your memories don't matter. No, that's not it. That's not what God is saying to them. They hadn't to dwell on what happened and the ways in which God had saved them in the past. They had to look forward to the new thing God was going to do. The past miracles were nothing compared to what God was going to do for his people in the future. Looking positively to the future with a firm grip on the past, that would offer the best way forward for them. That was then. What about now? You've said before that these past few months have been times never seen before by any of us in our generations. We keep hearing of the way ahead, that there will be a new normal, a new thing. What do you think will be the new normal? When we went into lockdown, mostly all of that was normal to us was shut down immediately. Before that, for some, they could go back and forward to the mainland in the ferry when they wanted to, unless the weather was bad and the ferry wasn't sailing, of course. We could go and visit family and friends, and they could come and be here and stay with us. We were able to go shopping for ourselves, meet up for a cuppa or lunch with friends, celebrate birthdays and anniversaries with a meal out in hotels and other places, get our hair done, which was a big thing for the ladies especially. Folk were able to go to choir practice, country dancing, to coffee mornings, or to the many other social groups and sports that take place on this island. The children and young folk were able to go to school Monday to Friday. Those with loved ones in the care homes could visit them or visit the hospital. On Sundays, we were able to gather together in our church buildings, which was and is important for all of us. We were able too to support family and friends after a loved one had passed away, and to pay our respects by attending a funeral service for them. I have to say that one of the most distressing of times though these past months has been for folk not being allowed to do that. It has been so sad. It seems so long ago when things were, as we would call them, normal. And now there is a new normal. As you know, we in Scotland are in phase two of the easing of lockdown. A new normal for a little while anyway. At least some of you will be able to get to visit someone else and go into their home to use the toilet. This will be good for family gatherings, and some other shops will be allowed to be opened, and businesses too. And what about the church, you may ask? According to the Scottish Government, churches may be able to open in phase three if they can put into practice all of the guidelines. However, there's a lot to be discussed before then by Kirk Sessions and Presbytery. In Isaiah, we read, the Lord says, see, I am doing a new thing. There have been a lot of new things done by ministers, parish assistants, readers, elders, worship leaders and congregations through these past months. We are gathered together to worship today, albeit through this stream. When we began this, it was completely a new thing to Angus and I, and to you in the congregations. Those who are not on the internet are hopefully still receiving a transcript of the sermon and prayers delivered to them. They have not been forgotten about. Others have been more innovative than us, though. Some have had Bible studies on Zoom. The guild here did meet together on Zoom back in April. Others have had coffee church, something like a virtual coffee morning. Some have had messy church to keep the young folk involved in the church. I have friends who have been having a short midweek service and others recording reflections from their studies. There have been many new things and good things being done in the church, out with the buildings, up and down Scotland in these past months. Many have been doing things they never imagined or dreamed of ever doing. It is the same with congregations. Many have embraced the new things, new ways of staying connected. However, I liked a caption that was on social media one day. It was a drawing of the inside of a church with an aisle down the middle with the pews on either side. A woman was standing there in her dressing gown and slippers, with a cup in her hand. It implied the woman forgot where she was, as she had gotten so used to watching her church service from home. It was quite funny. I'm sure none of you will turn up like that when we are able to gather together in our church buildings again, when the time is right. Although, if you wanted to, that would be up to you. As we know, man or woman looks at the outer appearance. God looks in the heart. The new normal. What will the new normal be for the church? I don't know. I'm not a prophet. I only know that things will change. The Church of Scotland, as some of you will know, issued guidelines last Friday for reopening churches. This within the guidelines from the Scottish Government. For churches to reopen, they have to be prepared and have a COVID risk assessment completed. As the document is over 30 pages long, I won't attempt to explain it. If you are interested and want to read it for yourself, it is on the Church of Scotland website, or your session clerks and myself can supply you with a copy. A few of the things in the COVID risk assessment that have to be complied with are social distancing, deep cleaning, no singing, Bibles and hymn books being removed from pews, wearing face coverings, hand washing facilities and hand sanitizers, no teas or coffees after the service. As you can imagine, there is a big, long list. You may have read the misleading article in the Herald the other day that was accusing the church of issuing guidance that is cruel to vulnerable groups within congregations. The Church of Scotland replied to the article and said that the article was utter misrepresentation both of the Church of Scotland itself and the guidance issued to the congregations. Again, that letter is on the Church of Scotland website. I'm sure that whatever decisions your Kirk Sessions make, then they will be for the good and for the safety of all. From the prophet Isaiah, we also read this. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. The new normal for the church, we don't know what it will look like. We are reminded of the watchword of the reformers, though. The church reformed and always reforming. That is, the church changed and always changing. The virus is still with us, although we have no cases in the island at the moment that we've heard of. However, this COVID-19 hasn't gone away. Christ's church will come through, though, this at the right time, for the good and safety of all. Not forgetting our past traditions, but building on them and hopefully moving on as well. Our God is loving, faithful and merciful to his people. He is working his purposes out and is the one who says, "See, I am doing a new thing." Will we be diligent in watching out for what God is going to do and be guided along by him to his praise and glory? Amen. We thank God that he has spoken his word to us today. We sing hymn 159, "Pray the Lord for the years your love has kept and guided." Hymn 159.
Thank you.
offer our prayers for ourselves, for the church, and for others. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we worship remotely from each other, we give thanks that still we are bound together by our Christian fellowship, united in the love you have for each of us, a love that binds us together in purpose and in commitment to serve our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Still, we miss being together in one place. We miss the beauty of our sanctuaries, the atmosphere of being on hallowed ground, those comforting smells of polish on pews and dust on hymn books, the normal Sabbath routine of communal singing, shaking hands at the door, of laughter over tea or coffee afterwards, and home for Sunday lunch. At home now, most of us are getting used to the new norm. The service at the click of the mouse or swipe of the tablet or iPhone, not even having to get out of bed or put on our Sunday best. But some things haven't changed, will never change. We just can't resist giving marks out of 10 for the choice of hymns or the content of the sermon. And as ever, we the church, no matter what hour we have tuned in, vainly pride ourselves on how good we are to have sacrificed time, made the effort to offer our praise and given thanksgiving through weekly worship. But true worship demands real sacrifice, not the vain things that please us most, but following where Christ calls us, holding out his love to the unloved and the unlovely, serving others, giving with no thought of being reimbursed. We know deep down the cost of true discipleship demands risk and more than a commitment to offering worship once a week. This is something we cannot fully understand, and if truth be told, dare not care for the consequences such rash and foolish actions entail. But our faith demands it. You demand it. Father, help us to look beyond ritual. Accept that the most important part of the church buildings we miss are the doors to the outside. The most important part of our being are the doors of our hearts, which lead out to engage with the real world around us. A world of so much need and so much suffering, and a world in so much need of your healing, reconciling love. In love and concern, we hold out to you those in need, far or near. We pray for our fellow church members, other Christians on Arran and beyond, all people of good intent, some we know well, others known to us but not so familiar. But help us to learn to serve together the needs of our communities. Bless the work of food banks and those who give time and energy to keep them stocked. And may anyone struggling to cope with daily living find encouragement and support. Through our witness, may they also come to know the assurance that they are loved, accepted, and precious in your sight. And not only are they loved by you, but known to you intimately, as are all their sorrows and troubles, worries and concerns. May they, through our prayers, know your strength at work in their lives, as they seek to overcome their problems and deal with their pain. We pray for our families. Many of our loved ones live far away. Even as lockdown begins to ease, we do not see them as we would like. We cannot hold them. In some cases, we are estranged from them or them from us. But they are remembered. They are still bone of our bone and flesh of our flesh. Be present with them now, Lord, and give us and them your life-affirming spirit. And be with the sick, comfort the grieving, and grant peace to the dying. We pray too for those we dislike, those we are suspicious of, those who have betrayed our trust or let us down badly. But we recognise that they too, like us, are very much in need of your love and forgiveness. May they and we find that love and forgiveness such as only you can give, and may it lead to reconciliation. We pray that reconciliation may be found in all the parts of our country and around the world, especially where there are racial tensions and people have for too long been put down or oppressed. May their cry for justice and equality be heard by those with the power to make necessary change, that ultimately righteousness and fairness, long overdue, will win out in the end, and soon. In you, Lord, we place our hopes, dreams, and our trust, both for today, but also for the future, as have so many of our faithful loved ones gone before us. Grant us the assurance that though we see them no more this side of eternity, they rest secure forever within your love and forgiveness, and the assurance too that one day we will see them again face to face in the joy and the peace of your nearer presence. We ask these things in the name and for the sake of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We conclude our worship for today with the hymn 465, Be Thou My Vision. in this midsummer season. Go into the world, be of good cheer. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Support the weak, strengthen the faint-hearted, help the afflicted. Honour all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing ever in the power of the Holy Ghost. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with each and every one of you this day and evermore. Amen.